for joining me for this first episode of the series Guitar Soloing. In this first lesson, we're going to look at the basics of constructing a guitar solo, and this will involve working with limited notes and how to manage your register when improvising. Now, this lesson will be the beginning of what you'll need to know to create solos and what the areas are that you need to understand in order to help you to compose a series of phrases that can stand alone as a solo within a song. Now, these lessons in this series are going to cover what you need to become familiar with when creating guitar solos. The handouts and tab charts for these lessons are going to be available to basic, monthly, and premium members at creativeguitarstudio.com. So let's not waste any more time. We'll zoom in on the neck and get started with the first two concepts of creating great guitar solos. Right, so in example one, I just want to start at the simplest concept. This is actually one of the first things I was ever taught when I was just a young guy starting guitar. Had a few teachers just trying to learn how to solo, and it was really great advice. I'm going to pass it along to you as, you know, working into the first, you know, I guess, adventures of guitar soloing that you're taking here. And the first idea really is that you want to have minimal ideas going on with note choice. And all we're going to be working with here is five notes. And that's it, just those five. There's a B, a D, and an E on the third string, a G and an A on the second string, and that's it. So, you know, really, a lot of times when people start soloing, they have minimal understanding of scales anyway. You know, their note choices are very, very limited. You learn a couple of pieces of somebody else's solo a lot of times, and then you try and make something of yours with that. And in hindsight, you know, this is actually a good thing, because starting with a limited choice of notes, you can be a little bit more beneficial with that, and you can yield some pretty tasty ideas with just a few notes. In example one, I've composed a short melodic statement in the key of E minor, and it's just finishing out around seventh position there. There's really not too much going on outside of just an E minor pentatonic scale. And in example one, it's a very plain, you know, no embellishments idea. It's example one A, and it goes like this. It comes in on the third upbeat of the third beat. So one, two, three. Okay, that's all there is to it. Very simple line. I'm adding some vibrato, but that's really about it. There's no bending. There's no hammer-on pull-off ideas. There's no slides. Nothing really. You know, I just added a bit of vibrato. I could have maybe even left that out. But the idea overall is that you want to have simple melodic statements that you start with. And that's example 1A. But in example 1B, we're going to get a little bit more expanded here with our phrasing, because we're going to have some bends pull-off, you know, staccato note. The idea goes like this in example 1B. It comes right in on the downbeat. One, two, three, four. Right? So let's talk about that. It's going to have a release bend that's happening from the 10th fret on the second string. So we're pushing that up, 10th fret on second string, hitting it, letting it drop down, and then we're doing a pull off into the 8th fret. So it's an A that's bent up to a B, snapping off to a G. And then we have the staccato hit. Staccato means it's very short and detached, just like that. Instead of, you know, a regular hit, you know, instead of that, we're doing this. Very short and detached. And that comes around over to an 8th fret G there, and kind of wraps up the first measure. Now in the second measure, we're going to walk up that pentatonic, and we're going to have a small, but, you know, it has to be well-formed, quarter step bend up there. So we're going to go like this. So quarter step bends, you got to remember, we're not really going as far as the next fret, because that would be, of course, a half step bend. But it's like tweaking the note a little bit out of pitch, you know? It just has that kind of like float, really subtle float outside of its pitch. But it's not going to be quite a half step bend, which is going to take you a little bit further yet directly to the upcoming note. So that would be like you bent 8th fret and made it sound like 9. So he's not really going to do that, but it's just kind of a little bit outside of pitch. and just kind of tweaks it. It's a nice sound. You'll hear a lot of blues players doing it, a lot of rock players, classic rock, even folk players, you know, doing some lead stuff in there playing. So, you know, keep that in mind. And really the bottom line of this explanation is that we've got two separate approaches here. We've got an approach that's very simple with the melodic statement that's, you know, just, you know, very straightforward. There's nothing really much in terms of phrasing going on with it. And then the other one is more embellished. You know, we've got a release bend, we've got a pull off, we've got some vibrato staccato note, we've got a, you know, quarter step bend release, and, you know, vibrato going on all those, you know, notes that I end on. So, you know, just think in terms of expanding things through phrasing devices like bends or hammer-on slides, whatever, or, you know, not using that in the beginning and being much more, you know, subtle, being very simple with your lines. And, you know, having those two choices to play off in the beginning with very limited notes is going to be what starts getting you going on playing guitar solos. That's really like step number one, just being free with it to decide on how things are going to get embellished or how simple you're going to remain with a very limited choice of notes. So anyway, that wraps up the first example. And we're going to take a short break, and then after that, we're going to come back in example two, where we're going to look at some really interesting ideas with unison notes, we're going to look at our articulation a little bit more, and we're going to look at how you can manage the register that you're going to be playing your lines within. When it comes to online guitar lessons, there's no place better than creativeguitarstudio.com. General membership to the site is always free, and paid memberships to access our step-by-step beginner, intermediate, and advanced guitar programs are offered in reasonable monthly and annual packages. Skype lessons are also available if you need more specific instruction one-on-one to discuss the finer details of your guitar playing. Sign up today at creativeguitarstudio.com. All right, in example two, we're going to be looking at the use of unison tones and relocating notes around the neck, a little bit on articulation, and really getting into managing your register a little bit more. You know, any part of a melody that's used in a guitar solo can be performed in more than one location on the fingerboard, and when this type of note relocating is done, our focus needs to be placed on how unison tones can be applied on other strings. So in example two here, I've composed a melodic statement in two different ways. Example 2A keeps the part simple and in position without any articulation. So it's just an E minor line, again, very pentatonic based. So working there in the second position. But when we move over to example 2B, there's some differences that are going to happen with that line. We're going to start the same, but we're going to slide forward from the 3rd fret of 2nd string to the 5th fret of the 2nd string. And we're going to use that slide as a way to sort of bring ourselves around to a new position on the neck. The new position is going to be taking the 9th, 7th, and 5th frets of the 4th string. And that's going to take place of the notes that we had before coming down here in 2nd position. So same notes, you know. You can hear the exact same, you know, as you move through that line. All right, so we're just moving them to a new location on the neck. They're what's referred to as unison tones. So, you know, the 9th fret B, for instance, is replacing the 3rd string 4th fret B, you know, the same tone. And, you know, just down the neck, we're moving to a 7th fret. And that's an A, replacing the 2nd fret 3rd string A. And we're meeting up on the same tone that we had met up on before, the 5th fret G on the 4th guitar string. So really great idea to mess around with, and you can take it further because I'm going to slide, you know, between those tones and then back. And that's really going to be a nice way to articulate that line with sort of a different sound, because obviously slides are a little bit different idea than just playing tones, you know, in a position. So I have access to two ideas here. The difference of the tone of the note on a different guitar string, because since the 4th guitar string is wound, it gives you a warmer tone, a little bit kind of fuzzier, fatter tone to it. Whereas the 3rd string, you know, you have greater length to it for one thing, And then the other thing is it's not wound. So, you know, on electric guitar anyway, it's not wound. So it's brighter. Now, you know, that's just a tonal difference between those positions. But another thing I'm doing in this line is I'm changing the location in terms of register, the octave, you might as well say, of my final tones, which are going to be a G and an E. So I'm playing those in example 2A on the fourth guitar string, fifth fret and second fret. But when I go to example 2B, I've relocated those tones up an octave and I'm playing them up here now. And it's quite a dramatic shift. It's quite a change to the overall sound. And that's something that I usually refer to when I'm teaching my own students is you're sort of managing the register that you're playing in. You have a register that you maybe are coming up with a few lines in, but you know you don't have to get too crazy in that same region of the neck. You can try managing over to another area with those same notes, maybe add some flair to them through some articulation, like maybe hammer-ons, pull-offs, maybe slides, something like that. And you know, bring the sound of the line into a totally different region. You know, you'll hear this done on a lot of songs. I remember, you know, learning Joe Satriani's Surfing with the Alien, and in the beginning lines that he's playing, he's moving around the neck with his parts, and you know, he's just getting a different sound because he's taking some of the melody that he's playing into different string sets. So remember this because it is a very strong idea that you can use in your leads. And, you know, when I am thinking in terms of lead parts, solo parts, it doesn't always have to be a crazed out, you know, improvised solo. It could be just even a main instrumental melody in a piece that you're working on. So keep these ideas in mind. They go a long way to really help you get more mileage out of how you're using your scales. You can tell we're not using a lot of tones here. Again, just a limited group of tones from pentatonic scale. So it gives you that advantage in being able to use less notes, but maybe do more things with them. So anyway, this wraps up part one of our lesson one on constructing a solo on guitar. And from here, what we're going to go on to next is moving through some ideas. I'm just going to grab my notes here. I've got some ideas that are going to come up on ascending and descending lines that I want to cover. And that's going to be fairly interesting because we'll look at ascending statements and how they sound going along the neck, you know, and coming up with ideas that they don't travel more laterally. And then other ideas that'll take us downward with, you know, in different locations on the neck and so on. Also, another thing we're going to look at in part two are ideas that happen between speed on a line, when you have a faster idea that you play, compared to more musical flow. So I'm going to have kind of a flashy attention getting lick for you to check out, and then we're going to look at, you know, sort of a slower lick and, you know, the differences and, you know, what the impact can be between these two types of lines. So that'll be coming up in part two. Now, part two, of course, is available to members of the website. So if you want to head on down to creativeguitarstudio.com and pick up a membership, you can try it out month to month for a while. A lot of people start month to month and get a handle on how everything's working, and then maybe even, you know, buy a couple of the handouts out of the store area. But you know, a lot of times what happens is people move on to getting an annual membership, you know, for what it costs in terms of, you know, all the access that you get and all the programs and handouts and MP3s that you're going to have access to. It's well worth the price. There's lots in there. So anyway, I'm plugging it because that's how I make my living, and hopefully you'll support what I'm doing. Otherwise, I hope to see you next in the members area at creativeguitarstudio.com. The Creative Guitar Studio Introductory Guitar Program is a comprehensive 10-lesson system with over 90 pages of material designed to take the most basic guitar student up to an intermediate level of playing. It includes all of the most important open position chords, foundational music theory, and music reading exercises. Plus, every lesson has a detailed answer key to help you correctly understand the material as you study at home. From reading music notation to guitar theory to chords and rhythm guitar, the Introductory Guitar Program will give you the foundation that you need to move up to the next level of playing. The Introductory Guitar Program is available for instant download in the View Our Products area at creativeguitarstudio.com. Be sure to head over to my website at creativeguitarstudio.com for the rest of this lesson, where we'll study phrasing of both ascending and descending lines, along with how to contrast speed with the flow of a melody. Also, if you have a membership, you'll get access to this lesson's handout, the MP3 jam track, and many more lessons. So look forward to catching up with you next in the members area.